to a clean airplane, we will now collect any items you wish to discard, including newspapers, bags, cups, or any items on the floor or in seatback pockets. Recycle aluminum cans when possible. Thanks for your help.
From a distance, our world is a very beautiful and peaceful place. But as you look closer, you can see overwhelming pain and suffering. We're so familiar with the scenes of devastation and poverty in the media, but some really grab our attention.
Devastation in Haiti, where thousands are dead.
After a powerful earthquake, the worst for 200 years, buildings collapse, trapping unknown numbers of people.
Hundreds of thousands are in desperate need of the very basics of survival: food, water, shelter, and in many cases, medical attention.
The devastation in Haiti that claimed the lives of over 230,000 people was not simply a natural disaster. It was caused by generations of extreme poverty that left the country vulnerable and unable to cope. The first time I visited Haiti was in 1975, and ever since I've been moved by the suffering in the world. Sometimes poverty seems overwhelming and makes you wonder if we will ever bring it to an end. But as a Christian, Isaiah 58 compels me to stand against injustice, help the brokenhearted, and feed the hungry. In this film, we will discover incredible and unexpected reasons for hope. We will meet some extraordinary people who battle with poverty every day, and we explore what it really means to live 58. Where better to begin the journey of exploring Isaiah 58 than the Holy Land? What do you think is the message of Isaiah 58 for today's church?
In the chapter 58, we know that there is a great concern about the way religion has been practiced. And unless you really care for the oppressed and for the poor, then you are not really doing God's will. You're not really doing God's work. You're not really being faithful to the God of justice.
Robe mi dani njiru. Kelas itu awe, ama rakin macam apa biit rakin amali mangkap, ama kat tanda, jualan orang kat gagap deh ama rakin agup dangkap, aran tanai cuk.
Oh gabul sama, akam gonere, gana mama kanet, asil leh guru gara sandu pada barre guru, ane mau duduk di bade, demne guru guru gana, gale bolok kebinne afele.
People living in this part of Ethiopia haven't seen decent rain in years. The scorched earth, the starving cattle, the failing crops are all signs of their daily struggle for survival. For the most part, this community is untouched by the outside world. Life goes on as best it can in this remote, desolate place. Kids play, families live, work, and struggle side by side. In Wakitu's struggle to provide for her family, she and her 11-year-old daughter, Taji, get up very early and head out into the countryside. They walk for hours to find dry wood they can sell. It's their only source of income. And as time goes on, there's less and less available. So they have to walk further and further. One day there'll be none left. It's a tough job, physically demanding work in immense heat, especially considering that Wakitu is 7 months pregnant. Wakitu and Taji have to walk 6 kilometres into the local town to sell the wood they have collected, just to buy water and bread. Like many in her village, Wakitu has very little, but she does have the support of those around her. And this is one of the beautiful things about her community. Walking around, we experienced a real sense of togetherness and concern for each other. There's something incredibly special about this, something that we have all but lost in the West.
One of the very heartbreaking things that I live with is when I see people in rural areas being buried before they start living. In a way, this is really a true description of what it means to live in rural Ethiopia. Many of these intelligent people die before their potential is out.
Odua zirate, Jesus Christos in Nagamachis, Nagamada, but I've been a fraud day who managed and banya. Payara betani, Garasa Garagayu, Parada betan Napais.
There is deep determination at the government level, at the church level, and also in the hearts and minds of individuals to reverse what we have been known for. The time is now ready, the time has come. It is like we all have one heart now, one mind, one determination to bring about a complete change. The church has to spearhead that change.
For many like Wakitu, the constant struggle for survival eventually compels them to move into big cities. It's often a desperate measure, a one-way ticket to a slum that exposes them to even greater risk. Originally from a rural district in Kenya, Alice and her husband moved to the capital, Nairobi, with the hope of finding jobs and an easier way of life. But what she found far from met her expectations.
Madari Valley is a place where 700,000 to 800,000 people live. There's crime, there's a lot of dire poverty. You have a problem of drugs and drunkenness or hopelessness. is a place where life can be very fast and short. This is the place that is called Mathare.
Area, let me say, most of the people are alcoholics because you are desperate to live. You have to depend on, yani, to forget your problems, you have to drink. Yeah, you forget your problems, you go to sleep, tomorrow is another day. That's the cry of the day.
This alcohol is the one we sell in our village.
And do people like it?
Yes.
Why do they drink it?
They drink it because of depression, lack of money, because it is cheap.
Thanks, Jim. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okoni kodo kwa wana madena maiki mono todo. Nyoko kwa regeni ashita asio. Okoro na eginya ko kudigesi tagosia mugukina. Nasionego kana ikitimutini yemetwere kena itorara mudu atari torware na wasi wasi ona rege wenyo bani uragia kuri kiari ukora ona kafa gukite ukora weja nigetha ukeona ngaga we uri utuko ni ukora mudu githini kamuru.
These humble homes are stacked together, hot, dark and very small. Sadly, most days Alice is unable to feed her children breakfast. Instead, they drink black tea with a bit of sugar.
Itoro ago kumadare ndio na awe mwega hari nie. Todo ginya ya jikaraga jikara kioro ine. Mai mama masiwe jima ikoro kwagira ginya murago ine. Yani na mako na magaraga ginya murago ine gukwete hayuraga. Niki ne warware otai koyo de. Na warware ni mai mama masiwe.
Alice works selling vegetables and fruit. She finds the produce in the dump of a local market. She takes the produce back to the valley, cleans it up and sells it on the side of the road. What is not good enough to sell, she feeds to her family.
You can never maintain a sense of dignity where you have no toilet, where you have no decent place where you can even wash yourself, even take a bath. Careful. You are okay now. Yes, sir.
It's quite rough here.
Yes. I'm sorry.
Visiting Mathare is a harrowing experience. Here I feel the urgency that as God's people, the church simply cannot stand by whilst people live in this way.
Amazing, Wes, to be walking here in this very Mount of Olives.
I mean, this very location is where Jesus was overcome with grief as he looked across at Jerusalem and couldn't help himself. He just wept over the city. This is a setting where he actually spoke this incredible, powerful teaching in Matthew chapter 25 about the kingdom of heaven,
He says, and so when the Son of Man comes in all of his glory, I mean, the sky is split open, and we're told that all the nations of the earth are going to gather before him. Then the king is going to separate one from the other. And when this huge process is done, then the king is going to say, now this is what this was all about. It's what the prophets have talked about. It's how I lived my life. It is what my scriptures are filled with, 2,000 verses about this. It should come as no surprise. This is about the poor, how extremely important they are to me. And he will have separated them by what, not what did you think, not what did you pray about, what were you concerned about, but what did you actually do? And so this powerful passage was taught on this location in this beautiful scenery. And the bottom line message is, the poor really, really matter to me. And those of us who are followers of Christ, we simply don't have the option when it comes to the poor of doing nothing.
And this is the message of God for us today, that God is a God of love, God who loves all people equally, and that when we see one person hurting and oppressed, then I am oppressed if I don't do anything about it. And when we are looking at our friends in the West, affluent people in affluent societies, they also have a responsibility.
Despite the wealth that dominates so much of the West, many still struggle to balance their finances. Kirsty is a young teacher and dressmaker from the UK. She told us how issues of self-esteem and materialism have often been a challenge for her, to the point that she found herself caught into a debt that she couldn't pay off.
I built up a lot of debt over the years. I've always struggled with handling my money. I remember when I got paid my first job when I was 16 and blew my paycheck within the first day. And I remember that feeling of getting to a point where it was all out of control and I'd wake up either in the middle of the night or first thing in the morning and have that sick feeling of, how am I ever going to get out of this? But the majority of it was spent on trying to alter or improve my image. I did have low self-esteem and I just felt that everything was centred around what I looked like. And that was where I placed my hope in me and my future, was in those things.
Kirsty made a decision to change her life. She began by cutting up her credit cards one Sunday in front of her church, and now is opening her eyes to a bigger world.
And cutting down on some of my spend, I've been able to free up some money to be able to support others.
Kirsty's local church has connected with the work of Pastor Joel and his church in the Mathari Valley, proving fruitful for both sides. For the UK church, the link has become a focus for prayer and an opportunity for them to engage. For the church in Mathari, the support is a great source of encouragement.
The church is a source of hope and inspiration for many in the congregation and also in the community at large. We have things like the malnourished children that we work with, bringing them to the church kitchen and feeding them with a well-balanced diet, and teaching their parents how to feed these children. We want to keep the young people busy with some activities. For example, we teach them the guitar, teach them the piano. There's a dance troupe. We have several of them in the Sunday school. We also have football, and they go up to national level in competition. That kind of interaction and good positive usage of their energy. We also have vocational training for the young people and also for the women, that they can learn some simple skills that they can be able to improve their lives.
I saw people that were in strife and had no money and were, you know, really struggling to make ends meet, but had hope, and they were placing their hope in God. And all this time I've been placing my hope in things. Their faith is so much stronger, yet they had virtually nothing. And there was me with virtually everything around me, and my faith wasn't where it should have been. For me, the blessing that I've had and that I am having is that my relationship with him is growing deeper and deeper and stronger and stronger.
Deep in the jungles of southern India, the Mudwa tribe live in the trees to avoid being trampled by wild elephants. Whilst the setting looks simply idyllic, with lack of food or clean water, no medical care, deadly flying snakes and poisonous spiders, this tribe are struggling to survive. With no money or education, many people who move to the cities from places like the jungle in India resort to borrowing money in order to survive. In doing this, they often end up in quarries, brick factories or sweatshops, trapped into bonded labour systems.
என் பேர் சிவம்மா. நான் ஒசூர்லேருந்து இங்கே வேலைக்கு வந்துடுறேன். தமிழ்நாடுந்தா எங்கள் பெரிய புள்ளி கேன் பண்ணான்.
த குவாரி ஒர்க்கர் கம்ஸ் டு த குவாரி அண்ட் ஹீ டேக்ஸ் அ பிக் லோன் ஃப்ரம் தி குவாரி ஓனர். வாட் ஈஸ் பெய்ட் இஸ் அ மீகர் அமௌண்ட். இட் இஸ் ஜஸ்ட் 30 to 40 cents பர் டே அண்ட் தட் வில் பி அ வெரி டிஃபிகல்ட் ஃபார் ஹிம் டு கிளியர் த லோன். Initially, they don't realize that that is a trap.
So will he ever be able to live without being in debt?
எனக்கு அந்த நம்பிக்கை இல்ல சார். எனக்கு அந்த நம்பிக்கை இல்ல.
Bonded labor is one of the most shocking outcomes of poverty. It enslaves people like Sanjeev and Shivama and their families. Their total debt amounts to only about $600, but they will never be able to pay it back. It'll be passed on to their children and their children's children. There's simply no escape.
என்ன சந்தோஷம், எப்பவுமே இந்த இதே வேலை தான், கஷ்டம்தான். இதில் என்ன சந்தோஷம் இருக்குது? கஷ்டப்பட்டு சாப்பிடணும் அதுதான்
சார். உங்கள் வீட்டுக்கு தான் உடம்பு சரியில்லை, உடம்பு சரியில்லை. நீ ஓசமா இருக்கல, நீ வந்து ஓடிச்சு ஓடிச்சு நீ கடன் கட்ட, அப்புறம் பிடிச்சிக்கோங்க. வருத்தப்படுறோம் சார், வேறு எதுவும் இல்லை. எங்கள் புள்ளி நல்லா இருந்தாக்கா நாலு பேர் கேவலம் இல்லாமல் பருப்பு எல்லாரும் படிக்கிறாங்க, போயிடுறாங்க. எங்காலும் மூட்டு ஏன் படிக்க முடியல? பணக்காரம்தான், முடிய மாட்டாங்க. அதனால தான் சரி எல்லாரும் படிக்கிறாங்களே, ஏன் நான் புளிமா முடியும்ல அப்படின்னா அதே கவலை தான், வேறு கவலை இல்லை. மற்றவங்கன்னா பணக்காரலாம் அந்த மாதிரில. யோ என்ன என் வேலை இருக்குது அப்படின்னாங்க. அப்போ கேஞ்சி கேஞ்சு வாங்கிட்டு போனேன், வாங்கிட்டு போய் தான் நான் குடும்பம் பண்ணேன். அப்படி இருந்தால் எப்படி நிம்மதியாக இருக்குங்களுக்கு? முடியாது, விரும்ப இல்லை. பணம் இருந்தால் எல்லாம் நிம்மதி தான், இருந்தால் எதுவும் இல்லையே. திங்கி சாப்பாட்டுக்கு வரல, அப்போ எப்படி நிம்மதி இருக்குது?
Ask God for anything. What would you ask for?
மிட்டாய் வேணும்னு கேட்டியா? கடவுள் பா.
மிட்டாய். ஆ. சைக்கிளா.
நால எல்லாம் சந்தோஷமா இருக்கணும். என்னன்னா பண்ண இதே வேலை தான் செய்யணும். ஆசை இருந்தால் மட்டும் போகணும்னா அது அப்படி ஆகணும். இல்லைன்னா இந்த வேலை பண்ணிட்டு நாங்கள் எப்படின்னா அப்படி ஆகுறது.
Won't you be brave with me? Won't you be brave?
This is something that we've seen all over the world. When children get around 12 years old, their childlike energy and innocence disappears.
Every father will have dreams about their own children. But unfortunately, all those dreams are built in the sky. In the cloud, it is not a reality. That is the heart cry of a quarry worker. When I say that I'm a follower of Jesus Christ, when I see these sort of a misery happening here, I can't be indifferent to it. In the Bible, Jesus has said a parable called as Parable of Good Samaritan, where a man was wounded and he was lying on the roadside. I view this quarry workers as something like that man lying down, dying without any help. And as a Christian, I would like to be a good Samaritan to them. And the church has to be a good Samaritan to them.
Look at this, what a spectacular place this is.
This is the exact location that Jesus had in his mind when he told the story of the Good Samaritan, recorded in Luke chapter 10. I mean, he knew when he said there was a man on the road from Jerusalem to Jericho that everyone would conjure up this stark, sort of terrifying, desolate place. To be compassionate, to be that kind of Samaritan, it takes some risk. It takes courage to be compassionate. This man didn't know, as he stopped to help this wounded man, that the thieves weren't lurking ready to pounce on him as well. To be compassionate in a hurting world means it's going to cost something. It cost this good Samaritan time. He interrupted his whole journey. It cost him money. He said, and Jesus even told exactly how much money, 2 silver coins. He said, you take care of it. Maybe this will help, but I'll pay the rest of it when I come. And probably most important, it cost him a big chunk of his heart because he had to enter into this man's ugly trauma. He had to get his hands bloody. He had to risk rejection. It cost him a big piece of his own heart. That is our Lord. And he ends the story with those incredibly powerful words, go and do the same thing.
The local church are doing what they can to alleviate the extreme poverty among the workers and their families. Samuel and his team have set up a project for children to look after basic needs like healthcare, education and nutrition. For many quarry workers trapped in bonded labour, this brings enormous hope.
இருந்தாலும் எனக்கு அதே மாதிரி தான் கஷ்டம். கஷ்டனாக்க நீ என்ன பண்ணுறது, கஷ்டனாக்கா இப்போ கஷ்டம் அதே மாதிரி தான், கஷ்டமான கஷ்டம் வந்துட்டே தான் இருக்குது. எங்கள் பொம்பளை இந்த சரிச்சில் போய் வேலை பழகிட்டுருக்குங்க. வேலை பழகி இப்போ ஏதோ பரவாயில்ல, வேலை பழகிட்டு இப்போ டெய்லரிங் வேலைக்கு போயிட்டுருக்குது. டெய்லரிங் வேலைக்கு போயிட்டுருக்குதுங்க. இந்த சரிச்சுக்கார நல்லா பழகி விட்டுருக்குறாங்க.
ಹತ್ತನೇ ಕ್ಲಾಸ್ ಓದಿ ಇಂಜಿನಿಯರ್ ಆಗಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ನಾನು ಕನಸಲ್ಲಿ ಕಂಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀನಿ ಅಷ್ಟೆ. ಓದೋದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬ ಇಷ್ಟ, ಮತ್ತು ಡ್ಯಾನ್ಸಲ್ಲಿ ತುಂಬ ಇಷ್ಟ, ಮತ್ತು ಆಟ ಆಡೋದಕ್ಕೆ ತುಂಬ ತುಂಬ ಇಷ್ಟ. ಮಿಸ್ ಕಂಡ್ರೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಕಂಡ್ರೇನು ಇಷ್ಟ ನನಗೆ.
கஷ்டம் வந்து நம்மளுக்கு வர்ற மாதிரி நம்ம பிள்ளைகளுக்கு வரக்கூடாது. நம்ம பிள்ளை படிக்க போகுது நல்லா பரவாயில்ல, இந்த சரிச்சில் நல்லா சப்போர்ட் பண்ணி படிக்க வைக்கிறாங்க. பிள்ளை நல்லா படிச்சுட்டு இருக்குதுங்க, 197 மார்க் எடுத்திருக்குது. பிள்ளை வீட்டில் நம்ம நல்லா படிக்க வேணும்னு ஒரு ஆசை. பிள்ளைனாக்க எனக்கு ரொம்ப இஷ்டம், நல்லா படிக்க வைக்கணும் பிள்ளைய. நல்லா படிக்கணுங்கிறது ஒரு ஆசை. அதனால் பிள்ளை இன்னும் என்ன வேலைங்கிறது ஒன்றும் தெரியல. இன்னும் நல்லா படித்த பின்னால் தான் நல்லா தெரியும் என்ன வேலைக்கு போகலாம் அப்படிங்கிறது. அது ஏதோ பெரியவங்க பார்த்து சப்போர்ட் பண்ணி நல்லா படிக்க வச்சு நல்ல வேலை கிடைச்சா நம்மளுக்கு ரொம்ப நல்லா இருக்குது. ஆனால் நம்ம கையில் ஒன்றும் இல்லை, அது நல்லா ஃபுல்லாக படிக்க வைக்க வேண்டாம் இல்லைங்களா.
ನಮ್ಮ ಅಪ್ಪ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡ್ತಿದ್ರಲ್ಲಿ ಗೋಪಿ ಮತ್ತು ವಿಜಯ್, ಅವರ ಅಪ್ಪ ಹೆಸರು ಸಂಜೀವನ್ ಅಂತ. ಮತ್ತು ಅವರು ಓದೋಕ್ಕಾಗ್ತೀರಾ, ಓದಿಸೋದು ಇಲ್ಲ, ಅವ್ರ ತಗ್ದು ಹಣವಿಲ್ವಲ್ಲ, ಮತ್ತು ಏನು ಕಷ್ಟಪಟ್ಟು ಹೇಗೋ ಒಂದು ಇವಾಗ ಜೀವನ ನಡೆಸ್ತಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮಿಸ್. ಕಷ್ಟ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ ಮಿಸ್ ತುಂಬ ಅವ್ರು ನೋಡೋಕ್ಕೆ ಅಷ್ಟೇ, ಹಣ ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ಯಾರಾದರೂ ಒಬ್ಬರನ್ನ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ವಯಸ್ಸಾದವ್ರನ್ನೂ ಅಷ್ಟೇ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೇನು ಕೂಡ ಕಣ್ಣೀರು ಬಂದ್ಬಿಡುತ್ತೆ. ಹಂಗೆ ದೇವ್ರು ನನಗೆ ಆಶೀರ್ವಾದ ಕೊಟ್ಟಿದ್ದಾರೆ ಮಿಸ್, ಈ ಥರ ಕೆಲಸ ಮಾಡಬಾರ್ದು, ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಓದಬೇಕು, ತಂದೆ ತಾಯಿಗಳಿಗೆ ತುಂಬ.
Because of the help she's receiving from the church in her community, Soundarya will avoid a future in bonded labor. But it also protects her from another horrific threat, the sex trade. This is one of the greatest evils today, a global industry worth an estimated $32 billion. It destroys the lives of the most vulnerable of all, children in poverty.
The families from which these girls come from are extremely poor. It just makes it easier for the traffickers because they know they are in need, they know the families are in need, and if they can tell them that, okay, one, I will marry you, two, I will find you a job, you can help your family better. Somewhere in the back of the mind, the family knows that this is not going to happen, she's not going to get a job really, but again, the fact that they're getting the money and that she's going to send them more money back, they allow the daughters to go.
We met a former US Marine and undercover drug officer with the LAPD who turned down a comfortable retirement in California in order to join the fight against the sex trade in Calcutta.
I organize a team of field workers that go out into the field every day and look for victims of trafficking.
When you go into one of these places, an overwhelming sense of darkness just falls on you. You know that you're going into a world of evil.
Investigators and the national staff that work in on our team are some of the bravest individuals I've met in my life. They go into places where we don't go. They go into places without a envelope of protection surrounding them other than God. They don't do it for the money. There's no pride involved in it. They don't get to tell the world what they're doing. No, they don't even tell the people in the community what they're doing because their lives are at stake. These traffickers kill people. These traffickers beat people to death.
If we don't stand up to an evil practice like this, it'll just carry on. And I think it is high time for the church at large to realize this and give these girls hope so that they will not have to be abused another day.
I've been in the military. I've been in cop for 22 years, been in gun battles, been in shootings, been in knockdown, drag-out fights, very stressful undercover situations, and I will tell you, this is the hardest job I've ever done, the hardest. Danger is very real, the stress is very real, the problems are huge. But here's the thing, I felt more used to advance God's kingdom than anything I've ever done in the past. If there's one thing I could tell people, find the hard things that God calls you to and do them. Because there's nothing better in life, I feel, than having God build you up for a purpose and being used for that purpose. I don't know how to convince people. I don't know that they have to leave home to do it, but I think we'll find the joy and peace that surpasses all understanding. I wouldn't trade it for anything in the world. Nothing. This has been the best decision of my life.
Jesus was riding this amazing wave of approval when he comes to his hometown in Nazareth. And they're so excited to have him here, they said, Jesus, do the scriptures, read this for us. And they hand to him the book of Isaiah. He could have read anything in that entire book.
But he chooses to read Isaiah chapter 61 and verses 1 and 2. And this is what he read. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim freedom for the prisoner and recovery of sight for the blind. And then he says, this day, this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing. And upon saying that, he made his choice. He chose to align himself with the prisoner and with the poor, with the blind and with the oppressed. And it was an important fork in the road that he took that day. And it led ultimately to the cross.
There are many ways to get involved in tackling issues of poverty and injustice. We've come to the US state of Georgia, where a coffee shop is modeling a fresh way of doing business.
One of the biggest impacts we have on fighting poverty is we're a fair trade shop. We definitely believe in the principles behind fair trade. We believe in alleviating child slavery. We believe in using environmentally sustainable practices in all the products that we sell. Another way is we give a portion of our profits every month. But a lot of times as a new company, we're not able to give as much money as we would prefer. But what we are able to do is we're able to be a hub for a lot of organizations that are trying to fight things globally. One of the biggest things that we as believers can do to fight poverty is, first of all, I think we can educate ourselves and to be aware. And when we do that, we realize that the way that we live here in a Western culture is very, very, very different than the way the rest of the world functions.
With entrepreneurs like Bowman actively getting involved in issues of justice, fasting some of their profits, and strategically linking with people in poor communities, change is taking place.
We used to say that 40,000 children die every day from hunger and preventable diseases. And now we're at 21,000 per day. We have cut in half the number of children who are dying of preventable causes before their fifth birthday. And one of the reasons for that progress is that these kids now have access to clean drinking water. Did you know that just since 1990, 600 million people have gained access to safe drinking water?
ችግር ያለብን ውሃ ላይ ብቻ ነው ውሃ ችግር አለብን ትንሽ አዎ አዎ ስሜት እየተሰማን
ደስ እየተሰኘት ነው
አዎ ደስታ እየተሰማን
Another major killer of children around the world is malaria. In 6 years, between 2002 and 2008, in that six-year span, 22 countries have cut their malaria rate in half. And they did it through simple interventions. They did it through insecticide-treated nets and better medicines and spraying to kill mosquitoes, things that can be done and are being done.
In my first born, I had difficulties with malaria. They gave me 2 pair of nets. I was very happy, because I would use one for the kids, the other one for mine. And I thank God, even they taught us to treat that net.
We are making incredible progress, but if you're only going to remember one thing from all this stuff that I'm telling you, please remember this. In the span of a generation, we have cut in half the percentage of people living in extreme economic poverty. The question is, what's it going to take to get to zero?
It's amazing to think that our resources can make such a difference to the poor. But money isn't the only answer. The church has a powerful voice which we can use to bring about change. In Ethiopia, the church has lobbied solidly for environmental causes to protect the landscape and hopes for the future. Now it has brought government and religious groups together to plant trees and set aside green spaces.
Where we are standing now is a good example of what happens when the church partners and cooperates with local governments. Things like this, planting trees, water supply, caring for needy children and elderly, the church taking the lead, and then the government coming and working and cooperating with the church. The thing we have seen here can be replicated all over the world, and the church can actually play its role as indicated in Isaiah 58, repairing the broken walls, whether it is a broken wall of the environment, broken wall of relationship, and then broken walls of production. The church can actually play a significant role.
Understanding that it is possible to end extreme poverty and that we have the very resources at our fingertips, it's exciting to visit churches where they don't simply believe this, they live it out.
Is not this the kind of fasting I have chosen? To loose the chains of injustice.
I'd say about 70% of our kids come from unchurched homes. And most of those homes, they're probably living on welfare. They're living in just poor neighborhoods. It's not just them, their two brothers and parents that live in the house. They probably have their grandmother and their grandfather and their aunts and uncles and cousins, and they all live in maybe a two-bedroom apartment. But yet, when it's time for them to be at church, they're giving everything they have.
In the heart of Queens, New York is Christ's Tabernacle. It's a church actively reaching out to the poor, both locally and further afield.
As a church, on Wednesday, we all decided to fast one meal, whether it be breakfast, lunch, or dinner, in a fast for global hunger, to pray for those people who don't have a meal, you know, the less fortunate.
When we ask our kids to fast and pray for the poor, it was really a place of the poor fasting for the poor. And that they're willing to give up everything they have because they know that God is calling them to do this. I would love to see world hunger come to an end because some teenagers in a poor neighborhood decided to fast for some people that were poorer than them.
So what would you say to churches doing nothing for the poor?
Wow. Get to work. Because that's what we're here for.
What we understand is that the practical is just as spiritual as the fast and as the prayer. When you meet somebody where they're at and you meet their needs, they're going to turn around and they're going to ask, well, why did you do this for me?
They're pretty passionate about this,
aren't they? So passionate. Because it's why we exist as the church. Just showing up for our meetings isn't enough. We actually have to get out there. That's why in the beginning of Isaiah, the prophecy comes through and he says, I'm tired of your meetings.
Some of you have been calling out to God for so long and you've been wondering why he hasn't responded, because he wanted you to step out, put your own insecurities, doubts, hurts, and pain aside and fight someone else's battle. Go on somebody else's behalf and pray for them, because he promises if you pray for them, then he will meet you. If you go to meet somebody else with the stuff that they're dealing with, you will see his glory come forth in your own life.
We have to be different. We have to think differently, feel differently, see things differently, and therefore, those of us following Christ, we have to act differently.
We know the power of our faith. We know that we can move mountains. We know that if we're bold and act out the way that God's called us to live, that we can change things.
When we wake up to that reality that extreme poverty can be eradicated from earth, we will become indignant.
I don't know how to convince people to get out of their comfort zone that I lived in for so long. But I mean it when I say that. I wouldn't change my decision for anything.
Now is the time to bring an end to the brutality of extreme poverty. It's time to say this stops with us. Join the unprecedented alliance of Christians worldwide and discover how you can live 58. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Now is the time to bring true grace. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Now is the time. Now is the time to
going to use us to change the course of history.
We'll live as you've called us, with hearts that break for the poor, releasing heavy burdens. We'll set the captives free, they shall go free. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Now is the time to bring true praise. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Shout it aloud and don't hold back. Now is the time to bring true praise. I hung my head for the last time in surrender and despair. Before I'm dead, I'll take the last climb up the mountain, face my fear.